Hello, today we're going to be building the Star Traveler model rocket from MPC. This is part of a three rocket set themed around the Duck Dodgers series of cartoons from the 1950s. As with any rocket model kit, it's a good idea to check through and make sure all of the parts are here before we go on to building it. So just go through the checklist and the parts. Okay, we've got two body tubes here, and one of these may be inside the other when they pack it. There's a lower body tube and an upper body tube. We have a tube coupler. This is also called a transition because it's transitioning between one diameter and another. This is the fin can, which will be inserted into the lower body tube and attach the fins. We have a nose cone. This is a motor retainer. It's different from the other two models in the series, which use metal engine clips. This actually goes into the back of the fin can, kind of like a bayonet mount, and holds the engine in that way. Okay, a total of three fins. We have a parachute sheet, some decorative decals, and then in the small bag here, we've got a shock cord mount, the press-on adhesive for the parachute, two launch lugs, and then the parachute shroud lines and the shock cord here. They're all kind of tangled up in a wad at the moment, but all are present. Okay, so I'm going to clear this away and we will get started on the first part of the rocket. Before we get started on assembling the body tubes here, you'll want to have a few tools and supplies available. First, you're going to need a hobby knife or some other kind of razor knife. A few different types of glue. First, you're going to need some general purpose glue, either white glue or wood glue. The white glue is not as visible after it dries, but it takes longer to dry. The wood glue sets a bit faster. Either one of these will work for this rocket. Just use whatever you have on hand. We'll also need something that can glue plastics. For gluing two plastics together, I prefer to use a plastic cement like this. If we have to glue plastic to something else, like cardboard or paper, a cyanoacrylate or superglue works really well. And in the case of this model, I suggest using a very thick consistency superglue instead of the runnier kind. Some tape, both adhesive tape here or the masking tape. These are just handy sometimes to hold things on temporarily. You'll need a pair of scissors, although in most cases you can substitute a razor knife if you don't have the scissors handy, and also a pencil. I like to use mechanical pencils, but it doesn't really matter. Just a regular old number two wood pencil will be just fine. Okay, so we're going to clear this away here, and the first part of the instructions shows how to build the body tubes together. Okay, now there are some changes here that I would recommend. In almost every case here, as you can see in the instructions, it's showing to apply the glue to the plastic part and then insert that into the cardboard or paper part. I actually prefer to do the opposite because it helps keep the glue from oozing out around the edges. Okay, also note this is the engine cap again, and this is going to go into the back of the fin can, and when it's completely installed, it'll go in and then turn slightly to lock the rocket engine in. This does not get glued, and in fact, for now, I would just completely set this aside so we don't accidentally put it in with everything else. Okay, so the first thing we need to do is glue the lower body tube onto the fin can. And this can go on either way. I'm going to put mine so that the little Daffy Duck symbol down here is by the fin can. One of the things we'll do after this is apply the launch lugs, which attach the rocket to the launch rod as we launch it off. And I find that the seam here is a really good guide for that. And so I'm just going to dry fit all these parts together, and it's a good idea to do this, make sure they don't have any surprises. But I want my seam here to go in between where two of the fins are going to be. That way when this has the launch lugs on it and we've got a rocket launcher that this will be attached to temporarily, the fins won't interfere with that. Okay, so then I'm going to take my coupler here, I'm going to put that on, again dry fitting it first, and then the upper body tube, again you can orient this the way you want, but I want Daffy Duck standing upright when it launches, so we'll do it this way. Alright, that one's a bit snug there, that's alright. And I'm going to probably want to do this so that in the end the seams line up here. And that's just for aesthetic purposes. I really don't, it won't make any difference in the flying because there won't be a launch lug on this top part here. The launch lugs will all be down on the bottom. Okay, now notice here there's a little bit of wobbling here. The top tube is fairly snug on there. I'm going to put the nose cone on also just to temporarily check, and it's pretty good there too. So the top tube I'm not too worried about. The bottom tube, though, it is kind of loose. That just wobbles around in there. The fin cam, not quite as bad, but still a little problematic. Now, since these are going to be glued in place, one thing to do is you could simply just hold it straight here while the glue dries. And the same down here. In fact, this I probably could. But what I'm going to do is just build it up a little bit. And we've got to be careful here. I'm going to use a little bit of adhesive tape. But I'm not going to wrap the entire circumference here because this is the part that's going to have glue sticking to it. And I don't want the tape to interfere with the glue. And so what I'm going to do here is just add a bit of tape up here, and that's actually a little bit longer than I need, so I'm just going to cut off some. What I'm going to do is just cut it so I've got a little bit left here, and I'll save that other piece, and then I'm going to fold this over into the inside. The rocket motor is going to fit in here. In fact, I can show that. So when the rocket motor is inside, it's being held by those internal fin-like projections here, so the tape's not going to interfere with that at all. Okay, and now I'm going to put another piece of tape here on the other side. And I'm just building up a little bit of thickness here. If your fin can is nice and snug in there, you don't have to do this at all. Okay, so I've got less than half of my surface down here covered. I'm just going to try and fit this again. Okay, it's still a little bit loose. And so I'm going to go ahead and put two more pieces in there. I'll go ahead and cut these ahead of time. And I'm trying to space these equidistantly. Okay, so I've got four pieces of tape on there now, and now I can slide that in, and that's not wiggling around as much. Okay, if you still have some wiggle to it, go ahead and just pile on another layer of tape, and I would do it just right on the same spot, so we want to leave some areas of the plastic here bare to make sure that it's going to bind to the glue and then to the cardboard body tube. Okay, so for this next part, you can use either the plastic cement or the super glue. Okay, And I've done this both ways. The way plastic cement works is that it actually partially melts the plastic here, and then that binds into the cardboard. It's not the strongest of bonds, but it's usually enough. Other rocketeers say that superglue is actually better for this, especially the thick kind, because it will bond both surfaces. If you get the really runny kind here, when you apply that to cardboard, it tends to just soak right into the cardboard and it does not hold at all. So make sure if you're going to use the super glue that you've got the thick gel kind. All right, so you can see there that's it's not runny at all. It's very thick. Remember, super glues, anything containing cyanoacrylate will bind to your skin immediately. So try not to touch this. All right, but what I'm going to do here is put this just inside the body tube. Okay, I'm going to run this around almost to the edge, but not quite touching that. I'm actually going to use the neck here of the glue tube as kind of a spreader to spread this around. And I want this to be about as deep into the tube as the coupler's shoulder is here. Okay. But by doing this and applying it to the tube instead of applying it to the plastic, when I push this in, the excess glue is going to accumulate inside the rocket around this edge instead of outside the rocket around the fin edge here. Okay, so now I'm just going to push this in gently. And remember, I wanted to center my seam line between two fins so that I can use that as a guide for my launch lugs. And now I'm just going to hold this in place for a few seconds. By putting the tape on there, that actually gave me enough friction that now I can just leave this here for the moment and let that continue to dry. And I'm going to push that out of the way for a moment. And while that's going, I'm going to do the same thing to my lower body tube here with Daffy Duck there. So I'm going to make sure that he's going to be upright when I get this done. And again, this is going to fit in here. All right, this is already nice and snug, and I'm going to do this the same way. So instead of applying glue to the plastic, I'm going to apply it up inside the tube here. And again, I'm going to start by getting it close but not on the edge, and then I'm going to use the tube's tip to smear it around there and get it relatively even. Okay, and then, oh, got a little hanging off there. I'm just going to touch that off. Okay, and now I'm just going to push this in. And there's nothing to align it with, really. I'm going to put the seam on one of the ridges here, just so it'll be easier to align it with the seam on the other one. Okay, and kind of the same thing here is, this one's nice and snug. I don't have to worry too much about it moving while the glue dries. Okay, and now once again, when we put these together, this one is really, really loose. I'm not sure why that one is so loose there. They must not have good tolerances on their machines. All right, so eventually I'm going to get this so my seams line up. But I'm definitely going to have to add some thickness to this coupler here. And I'm going to do it the same way that I did with the other one. Here, since I don't have any fins in here, I may try something a little bit different. And I will actually go around the circumference, but only at the very base of this, as I still want to have lots of surface area for the glue to adhere to. And it'll adhere to the tape, but then you've got a dependency of the tape adhesive to be holding this on to the coupler here. Okay, so I'm only coming down about a third of the way on my coupler. Okay, and now I've got a bunch of stuff in here. Okay. One thing I do want to mention before I go any farther on this, let's take a fast forward look here at the instructions. Okay. And I'm coming up here to where the parachute is attached and put in and everything. So in the instructions here, the parachute and the shock cord and everything will be in the upper body tube. Okay, and then the nose cone will go on here and it'll be attached to the parachute and the shock cord. And so normally in flight, when this reaches its apogee, the top of its flight, the ejection charge goes off, this would pop out and bring the parachute with it, and it comes down to the ground. There is an alternative. It's a little bit difficult with this model, but you could instead glue this on here, and then instead of gluing on this part, this would act like the nose cone, and you would make this so it could pop out of the top tube, and this would mean that you would attach the parachute and shock cord and everything down in here. And if I had a spare one of these models, I would show you how to do that. If I do come up with one, I will come up with a new video. It does take a little bit, a few other techniques. It's a bit more advanced, but it is something you could do with this. And the only really big advantage is that the hot gases from the ejection charge don't have to push so much dead air space. But you do have to make some other modifications so that when it does, it doesn't just shove the parachute and everything up inside the next tube there. So if you're a fairly experienced modeler, you might want to consider doing that just as an alternative way of constructing this. Okay. That being said, I'm going to go back to doing this according to the instructions and trying to build this up so that it fits snugly. Okay, so I've got this all the way around, and I'm just now going to slit the tape here in a few places. And this is just to make it easier to fold over without getting a whole bunch of crinkles in it. Nobody's going to see the crinkles, but it just makes life a little bit easier. Okay, so now I'm just going to fold each one of these down because they're not really doing much of anything. Okay, they're just in the way here. So I'm just going to fold them down here. That one's a little bit, I'm going to snip that too. So that's increased my thickness a little bit. Now if I put that in here, okay, now you can see here there's some gapping around there, but it's fitting a little snugger now. Is that a word, snugger, snuggly? Okay, so at this point I am going to depend upon the glue to fill in some of those gaps. Okay, and I just noticed on here there's a little bit of what's called flash here. It's just leftover plastic from the molding process. I'm just going to level that out with my razor knife here just so it's not quite as noticeable. Okay, so I'm going to need to apply a lot of glue here, which usually you don't think of doing this with super glue, but the thicker kind will fill in some spaces to some extent. Another alternative to this would be to use some epoxy on this, as epoxy is really good at filling spaces, but it takes a bit more know-how to use epoxy properly. If you've used it before and you're comfortable with it, I would say go with it. That's actually the best way to fill in something really loose like this. All right, I'm going to go back to my thick super glue here. I'm going to go ahead and apply quite a bit this time. Again, I don't want it on the very edge. All Now, because I do need this to fill a space more, if I get this smeared around here, I actually am going to put a little bit on this. And this is kind of a judgment call, because I don't want so much that I get big globs of glue coming up around the seams, but I do want to try and fill that seam around the body tube and this transition. All right, this isn't the greatest representation in the world, but I've got this standing straight up here. And if I change my light just a little bit, and I'm allowing this to dry in that transition there. Okay, and by keeping it straight up, I can make any adjustments to make sure that it is actually straight and true with the rest of it. Because of the looseness of that coupler, it's a little bit offset, but otherwise it's straight. And I'm just going to go with that. Okay, so I'm going to let this glue set completely here. We'll come back in a few minutes and do the next steps. All right, I let this cure for a good half an hour. Normally, super glue sets up fairly quickly, but because of the amount of space we needed to fill on this, I decided to err on the side of caution. Okay, but coming back to our instructions here, the next two things to do are to apply the fins and the launch lug. This is finished now, so at least the gluing is finished. We've got all three fins here. A little bit of glue had oozed out along the edge, but it's not bad. And given that it tends to bring the plastic with it, it's better just to leave that there than to try and clean it up any further. Okay, so now if we go back to our instructions, our next job is to apply the launch lugs. And as I said, I find it's best to use this seam here because it acts as a gluing guide. It's a nice straight line. And we need to measure on this approximately 160 millimeters from the base. They're showing that with the engine cap on. Here's the engine cap. I am not going to apply this until that glue is completely cured, just in case there's a little residual there. I don't want to glue my engine cap on. So I'm just going to account for about a centimeter there. Okay, so this entire body tube, get this around where we can see it without a lot of glare, the entire upper body tube measures about 29 centimeters. And the measurements they show here, again, accounting for the engine retainer cap there that I don't have on, so that first launch lug would go here at about 15 centimeters, and then an additional 11 centimeters, so that would be 26 centimeters, would put it all the way up here. Okay, so we're going to have one that's about roughly in the middle of the lower tube, and one that's going to be way up here at the end. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and mark those now. Just put a little pencil mark here. And these don't have to be perfectly exact in their measurement. You just need to make sure they're aligned. Okay, so there's one right there at 15. And then 11 centimeters beyond that is going to be at 26. It'll be about here. Okay, so I've got that marked. And I tell you, having this long rocket doing this, a little bit more cumbersome. Okay, now the next thing I'm going to do is right above those marks, I'm going to use my hobby knife and just shave off a little bit of the finish. And the reason I'm doing this is to give a better surface to glue to. As the shiny finish on the tubes here will make it harder for the glue to stick. Okay, and you just want to make sure that you don't go beyond the length of a launch lug on there, which on these things is just under 2 centimeters. Okay, and so then I'm going to come up here and do the same thing. I'm doing this just right along that seam. Okay. Now I'm going to get the launch lugs and put those on. Alright, here are the launch lugs. These are a little bit thicker than the standard launch lugs you find on most models, say in an Estes or a Quester. Any of the more common ones. And the reason for that is to make sure that if there's a little bit of a lip on any of these plastic pieces, that the launch rod will clear that. But again, the part of the way they did that was to wrap it in a shiny paper here. And so these also have a seam on them, and just like I did on the other part, I'm going to just roughen this up a little bit. Just shave off that top shiny surface. And I'm doing this on the seam of the launch lug so that I can place it against the seam of the rocket, and that will also hide the seams from view, and from the outside you'll just see the nice shiny surface of the launch lug. Here's the other one. I'm going to do the same thing. And again, just be careful you don't cut your fingers doing this. As in this case, no matter which direction I'm going, there's a finger there. Okay, and again, you don't need to go really deep, just enough to roughen that up. Okay, and I'm going to use the white glue on this, just because this is a part where we can see, at least theoretically, a little bit of the glue there. And so this is going to dry and be mostly colorless. I'm going to place some glue on there. I'm going to take my finger and just smooth that out so I don't have big bumps and dips in it. And now what I'm going to do, this is not shown in the instructions. This is a little trick I learned many years ago to help speed this up. So what I'm going to do is stick this where I want it to go. Okay. And then I'm going to pull it off again and wait for about 60 seconds. That will allow the glue to get tacky there. And I've actually done this enough that I'm going to go ahead and prep the next one. Because by the time I get this one prepped, then the other one will be ready to attach. If you're new to this, I would just wait and do the other one fully. And don't try and get ahead of yourself too much here. Okay, and the same way, I am going to drop it. I'll try to avoid dropping it here. Okay, so I'm going to apply that onto the body tube there and pull it off again and allow that one to get tacky. Okay, so by now my front one is dried a little bit. I'm going to place that on there, and now we want to make sure that it's aligned with that seam line. And so look at it from above, and you can also look at it along the edge. You can kind of treat it like a gun sight and make sure that it's straight. All right, and now I'm going to take my other one that's been sitting here getting tacky. And I'm going to put that on here. Okay, and once more, now I'm going to align this one with the seam. And now this is a, I can't really show this on the video easily, but now I'm looking down the length of the rocket through the first launch lug and then the second. And if I've got them aligned, then I should be able to just see the outline of the second one through the first, and it should line up with the seam on the rocket, which it's doing here. All right, and at this point, it's a good idea to just let this dry at least 15 minutes, preferably about 30, so that you don't accidentally bump these and have to redo them. It's also a good idea to allow this to sit horizontally, raised up so that the fin's not in the way. Actually got a sanding sealer can here. Okay, so I'm just going to place this here. Place another little bottle up beside it. There we go. And I'm just going to allow that to sit for the next half hour or so. And when we come back, we will assemble the parachute. All right, the glue has set on the launch lugs here. And the next step we want to do is to reinforce those. This step is not in the instructions, but any model rocketeer will have learned to do this very early on. We're going to apply some fillets of glue along the edges here. And I'm going to use the white glue again because it doesn't have any color when it dries. And so just add that along there and then take your fingertip and smooth that in. You don't want these to be really thick or they'll drip. And also be careful not to get glue up inside the launch lug itself. All right, I'm going to use this excess glue on the other side. Okay, and you can kind of wipe around there. And then do the same thing on the lower one. Smooth that out there. Get rid of any excess. Good idea to have a few paper towels handy. And then try and keep it continuous there. I had kind of beads there. Because if you get air bubbles in there, those are going to dry in. You may end up with little gaps. Okay, now I'm going to let this dry again, keeping it horizontal. And sometimes you may have to come back and do another set of fillets there. It's better to do two or three light fillets than to try and do it all at once. And this may come out fine. It depends on how it looks when it dries. If you see little dips and bumps in it when it dries, then go ahead and fill those in with another fillet. I'm going to set this aside and let it continue drying, and we'll come back while it's drying and cut out the parachute. There are three pieces to the parachute. This is the main sheet of plastic here that will unfold, and that has the parachute printed into it. We'll have to cut that out. But after we get that done, we're also going to need these other pieces. These are some adhesive discs that will attach this other part here, the shroud lines, to the parachute. These kind of come in a wad, but if you're careful, you can usually just tease it apart here into the individual threads. Okay, so go ahead and do that, and then you can just set these aside for the moment. Okay, this is a fairly large parachute, nicely printed with Daffy Duck all over it, and all we need to do here is take a pair of scissors and cut this out along the dotted lines here. Parts of this have some other instructions on them, like this part, so don't just discard this without knowing what's going on with it. It's pretty simple. I would suggest using scissors for this. If you don't have scissors handy and need to use a hobby knife, that works. I would suggest using a ruler edge to guide the hobby knife so you don't end up straying inside or outside too far and ruining the parachute. Okay, so just cut this in sections all the way around. I'm going to stop the video here because it's really boring to watch somebody cut out a parachute. But we'll come back when it's all done. Now I've got the whole parachute cut out here, and I've separated the first of the shroud lines, and these simply make loops between two adjacent corners of our parachute, and then we'll use these adhesive buttons here to attach them on. And it's actually easier to attach the strings to the little discs first and then put those onto the sheet. Now sometimes these can be a little bit of a nuisance to get off. There we go. And you might get fingerprints on there. It's a good idea to wash your hands before you do this part because the oils on your skin could prevent the sticky adhesive here from attaching as well. And what I'm going to do is just attach the string there to the adhesive, and it doesn't have to be perfectly centered because it doesn't come off very well anyway. And then you just stick that onto one of the circles and then move over to the next one and do the same thing. Okay, so I'm just going to make a little loop there. It does not have to match perfectly the diagram here. Okay, and just squash that on. And once again, I'm going to pause the video to finish this up, and we'll come back here and put all the shrouds together. And through the magic of video, I am back again with this finished. And so if I pick this up in the center, bring all of the shroud lines here together. There's not enough room in here to show this all at once. All right, let's got my parachute here, and all the shroud lines come together. So down at this point, and according to the instructions, the next step is to put this onto the nose cone here. I'm going to wait and do this as pretty much the very last step. That way we don't have the nose cone in the way of the other jobs that we need to do beforehand. So I'm going to go ahead and set the parachute aside here, and we'll flip over our instructions here, and we're going to work on the shock cord next. And this is going to be attached on one end to the nose cone and on the other end to the inside of the body tube. Now again, they've got us attaching the shock cord to the nose cone first. I'm actually going to save that till the time that we put the parachute on. I do want to draw your attention though to the nose cone for just a moment here, because there's often some flash inside this area here. This is a, what we call an eye. This is where we're going to tie it on, and we just need to take the hobby knife and cut around this and just remove that. This is just a little excess plastic from the casting process. Okay. Now the rest of the plastic pieces of this rocket are made of polystyrene, which is easily bonded by plastic cement and also by paint and such. The nose cone though is probably polyethylene or polypropylene. Okay. It actually has a different feel to it. These are nice resilient plastics, but they don't accept paint and glue well. And you'll notice that there is a seam on either side of the nose cone from the mold. And in a polystyrene nose cone, you could actually sand this down and put a little primer on it and eventually fill that in so you couldn't see it anymore. That just doesn't work well with polyethylene. And so if you want, you can use your razor knife and kind of shave off that ridge. It takes a lot of patience and skill and even a little luck. And I'm not going to worry about it too much here. I just want to knock off anything that's really sticking up. If you want to spend a lot of time doing this, you're more than welcome to. But unfortunately, there's not much else you can do with this that isn't going to end up looking worse than it is already. Okay, and as long as you're at a distance from this, it looks just fine. So I'm going to set this aside. As I said, we'll finish that toward the end of the model. Okay, now this little piece of paper that came in here, this is actually a rocket part. In a lot of kits, this is simply printed with the instructions, and you end up having to cut up your instruction sheet. But in this case, they give us a little printed sheet of this all by itself. So we're just going to cut out the trapezoidal part here. And if for some reason you need to make one, or if you lost yours from your kit, you can just cut this out of regular copy paper or printer paper. They're really easy to make. Now, in the instructions, it shows some numbers on here, and there's no numbers on the sheet or on the shock cord mount, but I'm going to put them in just because it's going to help us illustrate how this goes together. Okay, so I've got my numbers there. And the first thing we want to do is put some glue on this over the 2 and the 3 region. Now for this part, I'm going to use wood glue because nobody's going to see this once it's inside the rocket. And wood glue is a little bit stronger and it sets up a little bit faster. If you don't have any, white glue works just fine. It just takes a little bit longer to dry. And you can be fairly generous with this. You don't want it overflowing. Alright, but I'm going to put a fairly heavy bead of glue here. Okay. And the reason for that is we're going to kind of mush this around when we're done. And that glue is going to spread all throughout this. Now I'm going to put my shock cord from the top of the 2 down across here, and the instructions show this as being in a straight line. I actually find it's better to offset it just a little bit, because when we fold this, it's going to fold onto itself, and if we have it offset a little, then it folds beside itself and doesn't take up as much room. Okay, so now we take the 1 section and we're going to fold it along the dotted lines there onto the 2 section. It's a good idea to have something under your work surface just in case the glue oozes out a lot, which it's doing. This is actually good. Like I said, we want this glue to go all through here. I'm just going to spread it out a little bit. Again, have a paper towel handy for the excess. Okay, now I'm going to take the 2 and fold it onto the 3. And I'm going to hold that shock cord off to the side just a little. Okay, like that. And now I'm going to squeeze this gently around to work the glue all the way through and out of the edge. And again, I'm just going to wipe off a little of the excess there. And now I'm going to put a little bit of a curve into it. Okay, so I don't want this perfectly flat. I actually want it a little bit curved because this surface here is going to get glued to the inside of the body tube. Now, this can be done almost right away. I'm going to set it aside for just a moment here and let that set a little bit. It's actually better not to let it dry completely. And when we come back, I'll have the rocket again and we'll glue this to the inside. Alright, so I'm back with the rocket. And now this is going to glue inside the upper body tube. And if you look in the instructions here, it says it needs to be at least 40 millimeters inside. Okay, so that would be to about there. What I like to do is get it even deeper if I can. So basically a finger's length, because you need to be able to press this up against here. But the reason this needs to go in so far is when the nose cone goes in, it's going to be inserted that far in, and you don't want the shoulder of the nose cone to be impacting against the shock cord mount, because it could either break the shock cord mount or it could make it stick so much that the ejection charge can't blow the nose off and release the parachute. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is add some more glue to this. And it doesn't matter where in the circumference of the rocket you put this. It's not going to interfere with anything else as long as it's down deep enough. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and Just get this nice and even. You don't want it really super goopy, but you do want a good even film across there. And now I'm going to insert this and try to keep the glue away from the body tube, except exactly where you want it. So I can actually use the elastic here and look down inside. Okay, and basically I can go down as far as my finger will go and still reach it. And so now I'm going to press against the body tube and support it with my left hand here. And I'm just going to completely squash that down. And if there's any excess glue, I kind of squeegee it up with my finger and wipe it off here. Okay. Now we do want this to dry completely before we do anything else with this part of the rocket. So I'm going to set it aside once more, and we'll come back and look at how to put the parachute onto the nose. I'm back with the parachute, and here we have the ends of the shroud lines looped around. So here I'm just going to again kind of pull these taut to make sure everything's in about the same position. And if they don't, if all the corners here don't line up perfectly, don't worry about it. They usually don't. And it's not really going to affect the flight of the rocket in. If you want to get really picky about it, you can go through and pull in each line by line and then tie a knot in them. But I just want to show you here two ways that we can attach the nose cone. So if we come back here, the way they show it is to take this loop of shroud lines, pass that through, and then they're actually showing passing the bulk of the parachute here through this loop you make with the nose cone. It's actually easier to simply pull this like this enough and pass the nose cone through it. And then once you do that, gently and evenly pull that tight till it forms a knot there, and that will attach the parachute to the nose cone. Now I'm not pulling that all the way tight because I don't want to do that. I'm going to take this back off. I prefer to be able to detach my parachutes from my rockets for two reasons. One is that it's better for the parachutes if you don't store them for long periods of time wadded up inside the rocket. And two, I like to be able to change parachutes if I need to. So if I have a particularly windy day, or if I expect my rocket to go very high, I might not want a really big chute on there that's going to get carried off by the wind, possibly way far away from wherever my launch site is. And so what we can do is take a snap swivel like this that you can find in the fishing section of most sporting goods stores. They come in lots of different sizes. And the main consideration is it has to be big enough for the snap part to fit over the eye of the nose cone. But you also want it the smallest one you can get, so you're not adding a lot of extra weight to the rocket. So I've got two here. I'm going to use the bigger one just because it's easier to demonstrate with. Okay, so this one's got a bigger eyelet. But what we're going to do is, just like I did with the nose cone, is I'm going to pass the loop of shroud lines through the swivel eye there, and then pass the entire swivel through the loop of shroud lines, and just move that loop over and pull it taut again. Now, the way it is now, it's going to slip, so I'm just going to bump it down. Okay, so just like that. And now I can attach this onto my nose cone. Okay, and if you do this, just make sure that that snap is fully engaged, because you don't want this part to come loose when the ejection charge goes off, or your rocket's going to come down really fast and your parachute's going to come down really slowly. All right, now the other advantage this has is, unless your chute is absolutely perfectly balanced and all the shroud lines are exactly the same length, it's going to tend to twist in the air. And having this swivel here helps prevent it from kinking up as much. Now, set the parachute aside again, and one of the last things to do now is to go ahead and attach our shock cord. And you can do this just like it shows in the instructions. Something I will make mention of, and it's too late for me here because I've already glued this in. This is actually kind of a short shock cord for this size of a rocket. Personally, I like to use a rule of thumb with elastic shock cords is have them about twice the length of your rocket. And so this is not even one full length of the rocket. So if you have it available, you could replace this little shock cord with a longer one. You can find 1/8 inch elastic in the sewing section of most department stores or hobby stores and such. In this case, it's fine. The advantage of a longer shock cord is it's less likely to tangle up with the rocket during ejection. And also, when this does bounce out with the ejection charge, sometimes the elastic pulls the nose cone back and it can impact the rocket, cause some denting or some tearing that way. Most likely this will fly just fine. Okay, so I am just going to put 2 overhand knots in this, pulling them tight. Okay, and then as a finishing touch here, I'm just going to put a little dab of all-purpose glue on this and just work that into the knot. And this is just going to help keep it from accidentally untying. You're going to have a little bit left here. Cut this off, but not right at the knot. Leave about 5 millimeters there. That way if it does pull too much, that's going to catch and hold the knot in place. Okay. And at this point, if you use the tie-on method, your parachute would already be attached to this. If not, you can then take your snap swivel and attach it. Okay. And with this nose cone, I would actually use the next size smaller swivel. I would have used this one. I just used the bigger one because it's easier to demonstrate on the video. But this one's fine. It's just adding another, maybe 0.5 gram of mass to the total rocket. Okay, and then they show here preparation for launch, which would include putting several sheets of recovery wadding in. Now this looks like toilet paper. It's not. It's flame retardant tissue paper, and usually comes in squares like this. Usually your rocket motor set will come with a small amount. You can also buy it in larger packages at hobby stores. The instructions suggest 3 to 4 squares. I would use about 5. This is a fairly big tube here. But what this is doing is simply protecting the parachute and the shock cord from the hot gases of the ejection charge of the motor. That way you don't melt the parachute. So you just loosely stuff this in here. And like I said, I would actually use probably about 5 sheets. And then to fold the parachute, whether for launch or if you're going to store it in the rocket, I just gather it all into kind of a triangle here. Take all of the shroud lines and just loop them up onto this. And now I'm going to fold it in half with everything inside. Oops, get back in there. Okay, and then I'm going to fold it lengthwise to make kind of a cigar shape. And now I'm just going to push all of that down into the rocket. Okay, and there shouldn't be a lot of resistance there. If you had a problem with the shock cord mount and it's sticking up a bit, that could cause a problem, in which case you may need to replace it. Okay, and then just gently push in the rest of the shock cord. Make sure that snap swivel is not getting in the way. And then push in the nose cone. Okay, and then our last check here is to make sure that the nose cone has enough friction. Okay, so just give it a little bit of a shake here. And as long as that nose cone is staying in place, it's fine. So it should be tight enough that you can't shake it loose, but loose enough that you can gently pull it out. Okay, if it's really sticky in here, then you want to take a little bit of sandpaper and simply sand around the circumference here, smooth that down, and then try it again. If it is too loose, you can tighten it by applying a little bit of masking tape. And here you don't necessarily have to go around the entire circumference. I usually start with about a third to a half of the circumference. Try fitting that in there. If that makes it snug enough, then that's all you need, because you don't want it too snug. And in this case, I didn't need it at all. I'm just doing this for show. Okay. So in this case, this is really snug going in. I don't need any additional friction there. And I'm just going to take that back off. Alright, and then if we turn this over to the back page, the last thing to do is simply apply the stickers. And so the sheet of stickers here is meant to go onto the fins. This is your rocket though, so you can put those stickers wherever you like. But they've got them going on to each of the fins there. And they just peel off and stick on without any problems. Okay, and that's the entire rocket here. Let's see if you can see the whole thing under the relatively tight dimensions of my workspace here. Okay, and with that, don't forget, back here we have our motor retainer that we've set aside, so don't lose that. And I hope you have a good time flying this rocket. It was a fun one to build, even though there were a few little glitches in it. Hopefully your rocket came off even better than mine did. Have a good flight.